So they don't have any collateral. So what they have done is they have come up with this instead of physical collateral, social collateral. The way it organizes, it is organized is that when money is given to any group member, it is the responsibility of the other group members to make sure that he repays the money. He or she, actually, most of the clients are the women. So if a member does not repay the money, then all the other five in the group, they get disqualified. They will not be able to get loans. And because they need this loan desperately, because there's no other alternatives other than great money lenders, so they put this pressure to repay the loans. So there's this peer pressure works. So it acts as a social collateral in terms of peer pressure. And actually, when Grameen Bank was initially in the 70s, there were these very senior economists like Stiglitz and them. They looked at this very interesting structure of social collateral, how peer pressure works. And as you will see, the repayment rate, I don't think it was, the repayment rate for Grameen Bank is over 95% throughout its history. Now I think it's 98%. So this model is working. They're giving money to the poor, and repayment rate is close to 98%. So this is the background of Grameen Bank, which is conventional. So we move on to the and itself as a background of the Islamic microfinance institutions. So we look at Islamic microfinance in this second part of the presentation. Now, why Islamic microfinance? Of course, so if you look at the principles of Islamic worldview and the Sharia principles, at least in theory, we talk a lot about the social orientation of Islamic finance, the maqasid, the Sharia perspective, the maxim of promotion of human welfare and prevention of harm. All of these things leads to the fact that Islamic finance should serve some social purpose. So it should serve financial services to all segments of the population and promote growth and equality. At least this was the idea which Islamic economists had when they were talking about Islamic economics, when they were talking about Islamic finance. But unfortunately, when you look at the experience, the practice, Islamic finance has not contributed much to financial inclusion. There's not too much study done on Islamic microfinance, but there's a one study by CGAP. They found that Islamic microfinance covers less than 1% of the total microfinance outreach, which is consistent with Islamic banking. So Islamic microfinance is a very small part. I think Islamic banking is also close to 1% of the global financial sector, so microfinance is also similar. Now this is the survey which was done by CCAP, and they looked at the types of institutions and the number of clients they reach. The village and rural banks of this group, 77% of the number of institutions were village rural banks, but they could only serve 60% of the client. So on the right, we have the scale effectiveness, which basically shows the number of clients which each institution can reach. If you look at the commercial banks, which is in the bottom, the number of organizations in the sample which were commercial banks were only 3%. But this 3% of the commercial banks, they have a client outreach of 60%. So the key thing here is that the banks, because of their large size, they actually have great potential to reach the clients. And if you look at the scale effectiveness, basically commercial bank, 1% of the commercial banks can reach 20% of the clients. So the other NGOs, non-bank financial institutions, cooperatives, they are important, but their scale effectiveness in terms of reaching the clients is relatively small. So this is just an idea to give you that when we talk about microfinance or inclusive finance, we have to think of commercial banks or beyond commercial banks and think of the non-bank financial institutions. And the other thing banks, village banks, NGOs, cooperatives, they have non-profit orientation. So if you remember, we talked about the two approaches. One is the profit, for profit, and the commercial approach, and the other is the poverty approach. So the rural banks, NGOs, cooperatives, they operate on non-profit. Okay, so now looking at how will Islamic microfinance operate, actually there are some operational issues which are Sharia neutral. So if you look at the Grameen Bank model, for example, group center formation, going to the clients, weekly, monthly meetings, social development program, there's nothing contrary to Sharia, so this can be adopted. So because this model, group formation and weekly meetings, they actually serve the purpose of microfinance, so this can be adopted. The differences, of course, will be sources of funds and uses of funds. Similar to Islamic banks, so the operational wise they may be similar, but the key differences lies in the contracts used to raise funds and use funds. The one of the things which, because we're talking about microfinance and serving the poor, we can also think of alternative sources like zakat and law. Of course, for zakat, there are some restrictions of how it can be used. You cannot use it for microfinancing itself, but it can be integrated with microfinance. And waqf, as we will see, was actually even in Turkey, I think it was one of the cash waqf was one of the ways in which microfinance was provided. And in terms of use of funds, you can have sell these models and also profit sharing modes, at least in theory, in practice this is not there. It's very difficult to actually do. I have a slide towards the end where we look at, it's very difficult to do Islamic finance in the microfinance area. Even the simple Morawa is very difficult. Okay, so in terms of outreach sustainability, these are the two things we will be looking at. Outreach is because Islamic microfinance institutions will be structured as social organizations, they will be poverty focused, so hopefully they will serve the poor better. And actually, I did some work on Islamic microfinance institutions in Bangladesh, and they do operate like a social organization, they have social objectives, and they try to target the poor. In terms of breadth, because we're talking about the microfinance institutions are very small, they cannot cover too many funds. So in most cases, the scale of operation of microfinance institutions is small, but the clients they serve are usually the poorer sections. So depth of outreach is good, breadth is a problem. In terms of sustainability, credit risk is mitigated by social collateral, similar to the group-based lending, but the costs of operation are high, so they are not economically viable, so they have to depend on subsidies and grants and these kind of things. So Islamic microfinance institutions can resolve the outreach problem, but the scale of operation and sustainability are the issues. Now, as I mentioned, one of the key problems of Islamic microfinance is the Islamic modes of finance. As I said, the basic principle of Murabba is extremely difficult to implement in reality. Forget the Mushaka and the Arab. So those are, even Islamic banks don't do it. Now you're talking about people who are poor, they're not financially literate, and these are facts. I mean, as I said, some of them even cannot sign their names. And I did a field work long time back, and I mean, financial literacy is so poor that there are a lot of people who cannot even count beyond 20. So if you're talking about a number 84, they will say 4 20s and 4. I mean, they cannot count, as I said, beyond 20. I mean, this is the... So you're dealing with these people, so if you think of Musharaka and Mutaraba, it's impossible to... Another thing is, of course, when you... They are doing a business, the personal finance and business finance are all mixed up. So, I mean, it's impossible. In theory, it may sound good, but it's impossible to do this Murabba Mushaka thing. When it comes to Murabba, which is the main instrument used, even that is difficult because you're talking about hundreds of people who have different needs. somebody wants to set a basket, would need them. Somebody has a small store, will need raw materials. Somebody wants to buy a cow. So the microfinance institution cannot go and buy these things and sell them. So it becomes impossible. Actually, one of the microfinance institutions, they tried to do it, and then they gave up because it was impossible to manage the operations. So what they do now, they say, okay, when you come to collect your money, when the financing is, so you bring a member of your group. So they make this member an agent. Okay, so they give that, you go and buy these things on behalf of them. So they give cash to this member, you walk out of the microfinance institution, and of course, the friend gives the money from the friend. So this is the kind of problem they have in implementing Islamic finance. Now, there's no, what should I say, solution. Maybe the fintech, maybe one way to solve these problems, but these are the practical problems we see in terms of implementing Islamic modes of finance. The other problem, of course, is lack of funds. Most of the conventional microfinance institutions, they get funding from external donors, and a lot of them are concessional interest-based funding. And if you're Islamic, some of them are reluctant to take this. And I mean, they're on the demand side, they're reluctant to take it. On the supply side, if they see it's Islamic, they're not even eager to provide funding to them, some of the international donors. And then we have, of course, have other sources that are discussed, Zakat, Waqf, and Sadaqah, but these are not being tapped into. I mean, there's a lot of literature on this, but we don't see too much action. Other than some countries like Indonesia and to some extent Malaysia, they're trying to integrate the dialogue and sort of come into Islamic markets. And of course, being small, there is a problem of skill sparing. Most of these people, they bring microfinancing because they want to do some social good. They don't have background in financing, finance, they don't know accounting. So they're managing these organizations in a very unprofessional. That also affects the costs and the operations of the institutions. So moving on.
Yeah, mainly like philanthropic institutions. Yeah, I mean,
I mean they're doing microfinancing as an instrument of uplifting the people. And a lot of them are social organizations. But they want to sustain themselves, but if you are not efficient in managing the risk and keeping accounts, that doesn't happen. Okay, so moving on to Islamic banks. Now, why Islamic banks should go into microfinancing? I mean, you know, at least in theory, we academics say that Islamic finance is not only about contracts. We don't talking about just having Sharia compliant contracts. There should be a social role, especially if you look at the order of asset of the Islamic values and principles, they should have a social role. And the other argument is financing is a specialization of Islamic banks. So when we're talking about microfinancing, we are basically telling them to do include another client base, another business segment. So, and if, actually this can be done as we will see in the case of Islamic Bank Bangladesh Limited. They can provide microfinancing at a much more lower cost and more efficiently by using the existing network. But unfortunately, except a few Islamic banks, so we don't see too many banks coming into microfinancing. So the argument is if Islamic banks, they want to do microfinancing, they can use the same structure as microfinance institutions do to mitigate the credit risk. If you want to do microfinancing using the banking model, you cannot do it. We have seen it because you need collateral, you need. But if you want to do it as something, as a social, you can do it, but you have to change the mode of operations. For example, you have to use the group format, you have to open a specific department. But what you can do is you can actually provide the services at a lower cost because you don't have to have separate office, you can have your branches at a desk financing and operate microfinance operations from there. And actually, we have, before we go to the example, the argument is the debt in terms of semiconductor bond may not be good because you're talking about a bank, but because it's a bank, the scale of operation can be very large. And this is, as we saw in the C-gap scale, commercial banks, because of their huge network, they can actually serve a lot of the people. The revenue of creditors is mitigated by social capital, group planning, for example. Costs, no extra costs needed to maintain offices, microfinance, so you have lower fixed costs. If you are independent microfinance institution, you have to pay for the office, the building, whenever you open a branch. So these costs are not there for existing Islamic banks. And there's also lower variable costs that they have regional and branch offices. So I think there's actually, I've written a paper, it's a win-win situation if Islamic banks really want to do microfinancing. They can resolve the problems of sustainability. And there may be some ambitions in terms of the depth of the outreach. Maybe not targeting the whole poor, but they can target a large segment of the relatively poor population. And we have actually a good example